Hold up right.
House tonight.
Okay.
Good afternoon, everyone. The community development meeting is about to start and is called to order. But first of all, I would like to say Happy New Year to all our visitors and all our people that are watching the meeting, and hope they have a prosperous and a healthy new year. Now we will have our invocation by Paula.
Dear Lord,
I'm sorry.
Thank you, Lord, for bringing us together today. This evening, help us to make good choices, good decisions for the betterment of our communities and for the city of Jacksonville. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now we will have the adoption of the agenda.
I move the agenda be approved as written.
Second. It has been moved and properly seconded that we It has been moved and properly seconded that we adopt the agenda. Is there anything on our agenda that we need to go over? Now we will have the approval of the minutes from September the 1st, 2016.
I move that we accept the minutes as printed.
Second.
It has been moved and properly seconded that we accept the minutes from the meeting of September 1, 2016. Now the agenda. First, we have the we have our agenda now.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. So we'll move on to our agenda. Okay. The proposed agenda has been accepted, so we will go to the introduction. Mm-hmm. We have a new member, and our new member introduction to the committee will be Dr. Wilbert S. Arches. And we'd like to welcome him tonight to the Community Development Committee.
Welcome, Dr.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here amongst all of you this evening. Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you.
Look forward to working with all of you.
Okay. You got to do planning board nominations.
As you may recall, we do have one slot designated on the planning board that was held previously by Colonel Grover Lewis, who has since had to vacate that slot, so that slot is still vacant. And we, as a committee, you all as a committee, will need to appoint someone to represent community development on that, on the planning board. To fill our slot. So we had, we delayed it until we had a full committee, which we still don't. We have one, still have one vacancy. But I just wanted to bring that before you again, if you'd like to make a decision in light, or if you'd like to have us continue to try to recruit another member before we fill it. Don't know if that's really causing a negative impact on their decision-making ability. I would think it would, because they have a vacancy, so.
When do they meet?
They meet on the, it's a Monday night, but it's one of those.
Is it once a month?
Once a month. But it's not like, first Monday. It's first Monday following the council meeting, that kind of situation. I apologize. But they meet on a Monday night in preparation for upcoming city council meetings.
So it probably winds up falling.
On the first or a second Monday of a month, yes, it's typically when it will.
After their meeting, after their first meeting.
Before a council meeting, because it's, then it's presented at the future council meeting of the month.
Oh, before.
So it's the early part of the month.
First or second Tuesday, yes.
Council meets twice a month, right?
Yes, but once in full session and once in workshop. That's been changed, yes.
Oh, okay.
And the planning board items go to the full council, so that's only once a month, which is the second meeting of the month.
Would anyone like to volunteer for that position?
I'd be interested, but I'm feeling like, because of the meeting schedule, I would have a standing conflict with something I've got else. I wouldn't be free from that for another year, so.
I'd be more than happy, but I will tell you, I will miss some because of travel.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't want to do that either.
Because they have to accept the
they
nomination.
Do. It goes back to city council for an appointment.
Oh, I see.
Appointment. We take it to them to appoint it. So, if I'm not mistaken, I don't think that's the proper procedure. There are no other volunteers. Let me talk with management and see how they prefer to handle it.
Okay.
It might be that we suggest they fill it, and then should the slot becomes available, we have the first opportunity to nominate. That may be an option.
Because we did for a while.
But I would be more than happy to do so.
Okay.
And, you know, at the same time, it does bring them some corporate memory.
Yeah, okay.
Mm-hmm.
If Steve chooses to be on that committee, and if when he's out, maybe we can just have a substitute. I'll be glad to substitute for him.
Let me check and see if that will satisfy
okay.
any bylaws or anything that council may have.
I shouldn't speak for them, but I don't think we're representing ourselves as much as on that one.
You're representing
right,
you
right.
We are representing this body.
Right.
So that's true. If we, we could maybe give them two primary and a secondary or something like that.
Okay. Would you like to vote on that nomination contingent on management approval and support of that option? We can definitely.
I'd make a motion that, given their approval,
yes.
as we're stating it,
yes.
that I would nominate Steve Forney as our primary member, representative to planning, and Iris Foreman as our secondary.
Yes, okay. That's our motion. Okay. We'll take forward. Okay. Thank you.
I think it had to be second vote.
Oh, you had the second vote, yeah. I'm going too fast.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Same sign. Okay, we'll go with that motion then. And I think that's a fair one. So if he can't make it, we've got someone to fill in to bring it back to our board. Okay. All right. FYI 17/18 Annual Action Plan, City Specialist Tracy Jackson.
Good evening, everyone. I just wanted to report that we are on schedule as we plan our 2017-2018 Annual Action Plan. We have scheduled a community input meeting for January the 12th. It's going to be held at the Jack Emmett Recreation Center at 6 p.m. So that's next Thursday. And we're inviting the CDAC members to participate by coming out to support the meeting, meet the community, and perhaps facilitating the process to gain comments from the community. So just think about it, whether or not you want to be a facilitator to present, and we'll be happy to go over things that you need to identify.
What is that time? For
Oh, 6 p.m.
6 p.m.
6 p.m.
And for Dr. Artis's benefit, what the annual action plan is, is our requirement by HUD every year in preparation for receiving our federal entitlement funds, that we seek citizen input on how those funds should be used. So we do that once, sometimes twice a year, depending on what, how much money we get in, but it's been fairly low. We go out and have these meetings, seek their input, and use that information as we prepare our budget and decide what we're going to do next year.
And so far, we haven't got a budget yet, so we can't report on that. But it's usually the same type of activities that we funded in the past.
That's the 12.
Yes.
And this is also an opportunity for you all, if you see, have any ideas for new programs, as citizens bring things to you that we're not doing, that you'd like us to consider as staff of trying to implement, this is also the time to bring those to our attention.
Okay. Take care of your project updates.
Actually, I have some more.
Your project updates.
Yes. With our project updates, you all have a handout that Lily gave you to show from our annual action plan that we are doing everything that we told HUD that we're going to do, except the affordable housing piece for $200,000. We had to put that on hold until next year, but we are still going to be in compliance with our timeliness goal. So we'll be doing and funding that project next year. But everything else that's in the report we are currently doing. Okay. Also wanted to report on homeownership and rehabilitation. There are two rehabs projects completed to date. And we also completed a refinanced rehab loan. We also have two home buyer applications in progress. And we've also completed 11 demolitions throughout the city. Wanted to also announce that we are starting construction at 105 Newberry Street. That is in our downtown housing initiative area. And the recipient, she's very grateful for the opportunity for home ownership. And we're excited and hopefully have that project and that home completed in by mid-March. So that's when we're on schedule to complete that home.
And that's just in time for City Week in April.
Yes.
You might want to plan a ribbon cutting for that.
So we're looking to plan a big celebration for that. Also, of course, she had to attend a home buyer education course. I wanted to announce that the next course is scheduled for January 21st. It's going to be held here at City Hall. It's from 8 to 5. The cost is $10. And I encourage anyone to call 910-938-5286 to register for the class. Spaces are limited and they fill up very quickly. So please call in and register. I also wanted to announce that we're also going to be having money management seminars. We had a pilot program in November, and it was well received. And the next set of seminars that's going to be held throughout the year, the first one is going to be scheduled for February the 18th, that Saturday, from 8 to 12. And it's sponsored by the City of Jacksonville, by the Abundant Life Community Outreach, and by Rachel Galls of the Personal Financial Change, LLC. We had a very, very good turnout in November, so we're excited to be able to bring this seminar to some of the citizens that may need some financial advice and you know, learning how to get out of debt so that they can, you know, purchase their homes and get good credit and just be progressive in their life. So we are going to be offering that, and that's going to start in February. The dates are going to be publicized on G10, so we are very excited to start this.
Madam Chair, I would say before she goes on, that I attended the one they did down at Kerr Street Rec Center. Mm-hmm. And I would advise anybody who's watching this program to absolutely carve out the time and take it. It is excellent. The presenter is excellent. She has her own story to tell, very inspirational. And the tools that she gave us, and she did email some things out afterwards, mm-hmm. very simple to follow. And I just recommend it to anybody. Even if you feel like you're on top of the situation, you might find out you're not as on top of it as you thought you were, particularly when it comes to credit and monitoring your credit and things like that. But it was more than worth going, so I would advise anybody, group, individual, here or who's watching, to take advantage of that.
Yes,
very,
ma'am.
Very good.
Is there a fee to that?
No.
It's free. Fee. It's free. Mm-hmm.
But space is limited, so call
space is limited since it's free. And finally, I wanted to announce, as part of the process in planning our annual action plan, that we are opening up opportunities for nonprofits to come and apply for some CDBG funding. We have scheduled for Tuesday, February 6, 2017 at 10 a.m. and Wednesday, February 7th at 2017 at 1 p.m. There you will have a workshop to learn how nonprofits can come in and apply so that they can leverage other funding resources that they may have so that they can do more with their resources that they have to help the community. So we're going to be advertising this also on GTN. So if you know of any nonprofits, I'll email this flyer to the members so that you all can disseminate the information out. So you're going to have three flyers that's going to be coming to you after this meeting tonight. Okay?
Mm-hmm. I was asked about that mm-hmm. just yesterday.
Mm-hmm. It's that time of year.
Mm-hmm. It's that time of year.
It's that time of year.
And that is great. All I have.
Okay, next. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay, next we will have the Office of Livable Neighborhoods, CDC Administration. Ms. Lily Gray.
Thank you. I just wanted to let you know that the Office of Livable Neighborhoods continues to evolve. As you know, we are looking now to move from our first two pilot programs, which were very successful, which was Bayshore Estates and Belfort Homes. We will now be adding at least two more neighborhoods, potentially three. We met with our citywide team, which consists of representatives from code enforcement, sanitation, police, public services, oh my goodness, engineering, because all of those folks have relationships with citizens and know what's going on in the community as well, to help us assess and identify the next neighborhood that we'll be making outreach efforts to. So we will, the committee asked that we take a tour through the city so that they can visually see some of the neighborhoods and some of the concerns and assess which ones they feel are most appropriate for us to reach out to and engage. So that will be happening within the next 30 days, and then we'll bring back to you and City Council the next two to three neighborhoods that we recommend be invited to participate in the program. And we have had some interest from citizens that are volunteering their neighborhoods, so we are also considering on those. So. But we've had some very good feedback from the group that's already meeting, Bayshore Estates and Belfort Homes, so we're looking to replicate that. And in light of that, some of the discussion that we had with the summit, and I probably should wait till we get into that discussion, is at some point as we have these advisory group committee summits, we should have enough neighborhood groups, and the officers from those groups may be invited to participate, so we have some additional citizen input mm-hmm. from a neighborhood level. So it's been really good conversation around where this could go. So we'll keep you posted on that.
I'll mention too, again, I live at Bayshore, so we were part of the original pilot. We just had our Christmas party, holiday party, and it was December,
mm-hmm.
and had a real good turnout. Meeting people that you know, I've lived there mm-hmm. since 1982,
mm-hmm.
and you meet your neighbors now, and people come together, so it's very nice.
Mm-hmm.
And I would tell again anybody who's listening, if your neighborhood comes up for you, throw your hand up because we have gotten things done mm-hmm. that people have been talking about for a while. It got to the place where when I would see Lily, I would say, you know. Whoa, because, you know, it was hard getting home for a while because of all the new road work and mm-hmm. new paving and everything else. You don't want to complain, but it's almost like be careful what you ask for, you might get it. And they were, the city was more than on top of what we suggested as a neighborhood group. So if yours comes up, throw your hand up. Like I said, come to meetings. You will. Mm-hmm. I enjoy coming, mm-hmm. and especially when you see immediate hands-on progress.
Mm-hmm.
And you know how people will love to complain, don't want to call anybody and tell anybody anything, but it really was more than worthwhile, and we're continuing on. We have a website and network communication, and we're looking out for our older neighbors, you know, and keep an eye out for them and what's going on with them. It has really been a very, very enjoyable experience. So, you know, your city at work, and this is just one more positive thing I want to say about Lily and Carmella and what they've done for the Bayshore area.
Good job. Mm-hmm. And it's another thing, too, when you think about, you get to meet your next door neighbor who you never met. You've been living beside that person, like you said, for 35 years, which I don't know my... But I'm getting to know them now because you're retired and you're able to, you know, visit and not travel so much. But anyhow, it's a good thing. Now getting to the good part. Items that we're going to take back from the consideration for the city council.
Right. You have in your package a handout that was, first of all, on behalf of the city manager and city council, I just want to say thank you for your participation on Tuesday night in the advisory summit, with joint meeting with city council. They really did appreciate your feedback and have taken that to heart, and what you have before you this evening is a consolidated report and summary of all that was said and gathered during that meeting. I would like to read this cover memo for you. This not only for your benefit, for public benefit as well. What it says is the mayor and council will be focusing on making this a better, caring community for this next year. Already, the mayor has met with faith community members about how we treat each other. In light of a recent period of significant national discourse, everyone can help in this effort. Looking at how we treat each other is a key component of being a caring community. What actions or activities could your group undertake to make us an even better caring community? Consider activities and actions that would share the message of a caring community, or programs and activities that would advance what a caring community should be. And with that being said, they've taken your comments and divided them into three lists. One list, the first list on not numbered, but the back of the first page, is items that you mentioned in that summit that are already under study or development by the city council or others appropriate for consideration. So basically, if something that you said is already being worked on, it's on this page. There was another group of items that you mentioned that are being handled, are appropriate to be handled by others, including nonprofits and other partnerships. So those are categorized in that second column. And the third column is the area that the city council would like for the committees to focus on. And these are items that are appropriate for consideration by a board, committee, or our youth council. So we ask that you would review this list, look at the things that you feel this committee can best address, and then we'd like to work to come up with some recommendations, solutions, and ideas that we can take back. And what we really want to focus on, and I think you hit it on the head and Marcia hit it on the head, is we know we have brick and mortar needs. Always going to have that. But what can we do that is more personal, relational, to show that we are a caring community? What's more welcoming? You mentioned now through Office of Livable Neighborhoods, you know your neighbors. If there's a need that your neighbor has, you know, the good neighbor concept. Things like that. We really want to look at how can we demonstrate a caring community from that perspective as well. So with that being said, I'll let you, Madam Chair, and committee members review the list, pick out those items that you think speaks to this committee's mission most, and start that. Yes.
Okay, we'll start and go around the table. We'll hear your ideas, because we was at the meeting the other night. Maybe the new ones have some ideas that we haven't heard, you know, that could be added to this list down at the other end.
You just
talk about it. So we could start, okay. You want me to go ahead and read them out?
I guess it would help to read them out.
You don't have anything that we, I'm talking to the you two. I know you weren't at, were you at the meeting?
Yeah.
Yes.
You was at the meeting?
Just about everybody was
okay, so she was there. Okay, so high school activities that don't just include sports. And I think Marcia had said something about this way back in a meeting that we had in 2016. Remember that? Because about the girl that was swimming. You remember you said about swimming?
Yes.
So would you expound on that a little bit? Because that is very important.
Well, most of our extracurricular things for kids seem to me, from looking outside looking in, especially in school, center around sports. If you're not involved in basketball, you know, you're standing basketball, soccer, baseball, whatever it is, you don't have, you may not have a lot to do that you can get involved in, and there's not a whole lot of highlighting. Not to say that they don't pay attention, but you know, the paper's full of the latest basketball, football, whatever it is. And somebody mentioned the meeting the other night about art. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of kids who are into art and music. And unfortunately, when schools face budget cuts, the first thing they want to get rid of are your foreign languages, your arts classes, your music, things like that. And so I don't know that, I think when they talked to us the other night, they asked us to come together and figure out from this list, what could we as a CDAC
do? Right. And that's an example of an activity that I would envision the youth council taking on that and coming up with what they feel should be done. Mm-hmm. But things like this committee could possibly help facilitate would be the monthly awareness forums, expanding clean and green for neighborhoods, which is also an environmental appearance type of thing, but we also deal with slum and blight and code enforcement and the Office of Livable Neighborhoods. Possibly opportunities for extended activities and better communication of existing acts. I think all committees could probably work on that. It's relevant to their particular area. And better communication, as you know, Office of Livable Neighborhoods is also responsible for volunteer, and I say Office of Livable Neighborhoods because it falls under community development now, so I get it. But the volunteering and nonprofit needs of which we fund, we use some of our community development funding to support nonprofits. So those are things that I think fall under the community development umbrella more so than some of the other ones may.
Yes.
So that would suggest you consider
some. Now the other night, I was the one who mentioned the intergenerational cooperation, and the reason I did was because this is a very young county. It is the youngest county in North Carolina in terms of median age, because the median age for the state is 28, I think, and for this county is 23, barely 23. Ooh. And it being in health services, we will hear about some of the young mothers that are here. They're away from home, have no family here. And they will literally go into the emergency room and run up a $600-800 bill for diaper rash because they know anything about a tube of Desitin, you know. And some of these young ladies are, when I say they're mothers for the first time, they have touched a baby for the first time when they had their own, as opposed to my generation. You were so busy babysitting every child in the neighborhood until you had loads of experience by the time you came into this. Some of these young ladies are touching a baby for the first time. And they need support, particularly if someone's deployed and they just don't have anybody here. And on the other hand, you have a growing retirement community here. And empty nesters who may be not necessarily wanting the child back home full time, but they're hankering on occasion, as I am, for periodic nurturing. Now, you don't want the 24/7 you did when you raised them, but you wouldn't mind having your hands on a baby every now and again. And there'd be a lot of logistics involved in terms of, you know, screening, just all, but I wasn't interested in that. I was just interested in having a young girl who, because the mentoring programs around here also are generally tied to, unfortunately, a mistake a young person makes. And then they get into mentoring through law enforcement. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about just the neighborhoods when you start meeting each other in those meetings, and you have someone who is in there struggling with two or three young children, and somebody who wouldn't mind partnering with her. You know, well, you know, when you get ready to go out somewhere, call me. I'll go with you to the park, or I'll go with you to the mall, or you can stop by and sit in the yard, or the things we used to do and don't do anymore.
And that's an example of a care community type of activity that I think we would try to...
That would keep a mother here rather than having her packing up and going home and leaving and taking her spending power with her. Mm-hmm. She can stay here and...
offer support.
Mm-hmm. And offer support from an
older generation.
And if we had, I'm looking at it like this too. If we had, because I know when I first got here, I didn't know anyone here. So I used to drive from here to Greenville every weekend. My husband was in Vietnam. And I would drive every Saturday afternoon after I finished working on the base. I would get in the car and drive to Greenville. I'd come back Sunday night, take my son, come back here, because I didn't know anyone, you know. And I felt like I was alone because I wasn't with family, because we had just left the base with 8 years, and these were the people that I knew. So this is the mainstay of military. Mm-hmm. And like they said, time you get to know someone, they snatched away from you, you know, and then you're all alone again. But saying this, I met a young girl that lived across the street from me this Christmas. And the thing that happened in Tennessee, her family lost a lot of their home. Oh. So that being said, I bought toys for her kids, because she told me, she said, we're not going home, we can't afford it. And she said, and there's no place for us to go because my parents are staying with someone. And she said, and we just don't have the money to even, she said, but I will get my kids some food. And I told her, I didn't tell her at first, but then when Christmas came, I called the husband, and I told him, I said, come over to the house, I got something for you. So she's got four kids and pregnant with another one. So I bought toys for all the kids, and then, of course, I got some food from church and took it to her. She stood out there and talked to me for 2 hours in the yard, and I still don't know her name. But it was so nice, and she's very young. Mm-hmm. But the thing about it that felt so good was what we was talking about, you know. And she said, I'm so glad I got to know you. And she said, I've been living across the street, so I've been meaning to come and meet you, but I don't have time. I'm always watching the kids. So I told her, I said, well, I'm standing in the door most of the time watching to make sure they don't run in the street. I said, but you just don't know I'm there. Mm-hmm. I said, but anytime you want to come over, come on over, I'm here. You know, whenever you see the car, I'm here. And I'll be glad to help you in any way I can. Mm-hmm. And I think, to me, this is what happened to me when I was in California. Yeah. Some lady did the same thing to me, so I passed it on. Mm-hmm. And I'm saying, if we could do that, just one person at a time, mm-hmm. you know how many we'd reach?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's great.
That's a lot of people, because she's going to tell someone else. Mm-hmm. And then they would feel the same way in what she can do. So that's all I'm asking. If you could just, you know, reach out and touch the person's life. It doesn't have to be much. They're not looking for a whole lot. Sometimes they're just looking for a kind face.
Somebody to listen. You say. Mm-hmm. Someone to listen.
Yeah, that's to it. Talk to. That's what she was telling me about what happened in Tennessee to their family, you know. So I was glad I was able to listen to her. But
you said getting back to that, we really clean. Should be. I'm trying to sort of put check marks
that
beside
part
the
about caring community.
One of the things that we had Environmental Appearance Subcommittee meeting this morning. They had some great discussions, which they'll be taking back to the full ENA. Mm-hmm. But one of them that, one of the suggestions, there were several good ones, but one that stood out to me, because it's one that you all have mentioned before, was the community gardens.
Oh, yeah.
And so what we have, what I would like to see is maybe we invite the young lady in from Cooperative Extension that runs the community garden program, maybe have a joint workshop with this group and ENA on how to implement a community garden program. And, you know, you can call them caring community gardens. And that's another way to bring people together, share the food, you know, and do that in the spirit of a caring community. That was one idea. Or possibly use some vacant lots for, use the community garden, not just for food, but for plantings, give away seeds and things that people can then take back to beautify their yards and things of that nature. Another idea was to implement a power washing program. They're similar to like the dollar truck. You can call now and get the dollar truck, and then the city will pick it up and you put your debris in it. What if you could call and borrow a power washing tool and power wash your house, and your neighbor could help you know that somebody doesn't have that equipment, and we can work together to improve and clean up our neighborhoods. Those kind of things that, of that nature.
Like you said, little bitty things that doesn't, little you things. Don't take a whole lot.
Right.
If I may, new job requirements seems like something that this board, along with the representative on the planning board, would have some wonderful insight into. This is just not a national problem, but this is a problem here locally as well with jobs and employment opportunities, some ways to raise our economic status here in our county, the city of Jacksonville. So that would be something that I think this board could be instrumental in assisting with, is finding ways not just to create new jobs, because we can't do that by ourselves, but to talk about the requirements, the options that would afford people the opportunity to get these jobs or you know, creating some other non-retail industries that can help job advancement and job growth. I think that's instrumental in us trying to assist and make that happen in this community.
Mm-hmm. And the young lady who sat at our table from the youth group, she mentioned jobs for youth, and I told her when we first came here in 1979, there was a summer youth employment program, probably administered by the county. You remember what I'm talking about?
Yeah,
and if you were a child, a young person, I should say, a young person who wanted a job and you qualified to get a work permit because you have to be a certain age, there was an 8-week at minimum wage summer job waiting for you, and they did all the things like cleaning up. They did various things. And she said, you'd be surprised how many kids that she, I guess, sees in school. She's a sophomore in school and knows really want to work to help the family because they're living in situations where there's not enough money coming through the door. Mm-hmm. And so they have difficulties, you know, just in the social life and school and things. But she said, you know, just their kids are interested in working and bringing money into the house to help the parent or parents. And, you know, you don't think so much about that, you know, anymore. You used to think about us taking care of the kids. But, you know, she said that she felt it was a way to defer kids from sometimes getting involved in crime. Mm-hmm. Because from their point of view, they're going to, some of them will do what they have to do or what they think they have to do, bring money in. And she said this would be a way to teach skills, to get some experience. Hard to apply for a brand new job if you don't have any working skills, you know, or any job experience. And so she mentioned that. Mm-hmm. And so that might be, I don't know how far
we can
go
three.
With that.
I think that's probably enough mm-hmm. for your plate. You've got expand clean and green, intergenerational cooperation, and new job requirements.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to say something on this new job requirement. Mm-hmm. What we say is all well and good, but we need jobs here in Onslow County and in Jacksonville City where you can make money.
Mm-hmm. But that's just, what it's saying.
That's what mm-hmm. I'm just going over just mm-hmm. a little bit what you're saying. Mm-hmm. The reason why is because the McDonald's and Burger King's and all this stuff is good for mm-hmm. summer jobs like the kids do. But what you do when the kids get out of school, mm-hmm. they go to college, mm-hmm. 4-year, whatever, get their bachelor, whatever, come back to Jacksonville. We talked about this one time before, mm-hmm. why the children don't stay here in Jacksonville. Mm-hmm. I'm going to give you a illustration. Mm-hmm. My son went to school. And 4 years of college and whatever else it went through. He come back here, he said, Daddy, I've been looking for a job in Jacksonville and ain't nothing here. Mm-hmm. He said, I even looked for jobs that's what he went to school for. Mm-hmm. Still can't find a job. Mm-hmm. He said, I'm going to Raleigh. Mm-hmm. He commute mm-hmm. back and forth to Raleigh from Jacksonville.
He didn't move?
He moved, but he didn't like Raleigh because mm-hmm. of the traffic. Mm-hmm. So he commutes back and forth. Mm-hmm. Now my other son, he do the same work on Camp Lejeune. Mm-hmm. He commutes back and forth from Maryland because he don't like it there, but he travels back and forth. And I said, well, why don't y'all get a job here? Because we can't make no money. My other son graduated from Fairville University.
Fairville State University.
Right, okay, I got it right. Okay, you got it. But anyway, he graduated from there. It frustrated him, he got a job at Walmart. It frustrated him so bad, he quit Walmart, came home, laid on the couch. I said, son, I said, can't you find a job? I said, there's plenty of jobs out there. Dad, ain't no jobs out there for us. He said, I'm just frustrated. I said, what you gonna do? I said, well, just like I told you in the beginning, if you wanna take a break from school, take a break from school, I'll take care of you. I said, because I know what it was like when I went to school, when I got out of high school, I wanted to just sit down, because I was taught high school. But he didn't do that. He still wanted a job. He finally got up one day, he come back, he said, Daddy, I'm going in the military. I said, you're right. Because they talked about the military like, oh man, like it was a disaster. I come home one day and I look at his head, I said, you got to be kidding me. He wet them dreads. And his head balled in the mouth.
Oh, man.
He
went in the military.
He did. My baby. Simeon. Uh-huh. I couldn't believe it. I said, you really going to the military? He said, yeah. I said, okay, I see it. I believe it. When he graduated from boot camp, he drove to Oklahoma. Mm-hmm. I said, I got to see this. He went to Oklahoma. Sure enough, he went in the military. He said, because I can't find no jobs in Jacksonville. And I thought about this, what we talks about here. And not only them, but other students and other kids is in the same situation. They don't want to work at McDonald's. They don't want to work at Burger King's, any place. They need something where they can make money.
I didn't mean to interrupt you, but I know this is something that our economic development professionals are all aware of and have tried to figure out strategies for how we bring industry here. There are a number of pros and cons and barriers and things that need to be overcome to make that happen. So, but what we would need to look at is what can we do as a committee, because we're not an economic development recruitment body, but what can we do to make this city an attractive place for businesses to come? Because one of the things I think somebody mentioned, just cleaning up a city could be a deal breaker between a business picking us over another city. So that may be something that we could do at our level, make the city clean, to be welcoming to visitors when they come, to have a reputation of a place that you do want to live, to make us as competitive from a caring community perspective, to help the economic development professionals do their job.
Now, one question I have, it links back to you. We did at one point, and I can't remember whether we still have that on the agenda. Mm-hmm. We used to give small business loans to businesses, and they may have, say, 95% of their funding or all the 99%, and may need just one little other piece of it to come in. Mm-hmm. And I didn't know whether, because I know our funding gets cut back year after year after year.
That's where it went, and that's something you could consider. Now, I could tell you the reason we did it. We stopped it. It's the most high-risk investment we can make with the amount. We do not have a lot of money.
Yeah.
As it is. You're talking about $300,000. Take 20% off of that. You're really talking about small money, not a lot of money. And once you start making $30,000, $40,000, $50,000, $60,000 loans, is what someone needs to start up a business. And in 2 years, they're gone.
Yeah.
And that money's gone.
I remember.
And you have no results, no jobs created. That we felt just wasn't the best investment for the city to make, particularly when there were other resources out there that had more money and pools of money that they could use. So what we started doing is referring people to places like the NC Rural Center, the Building Reuse Program, and Small Business Center, the Micro Enterprise Loan Programs, the other resources that were out there, so that we didn't take that kind of risk on with the city funding, and then we can use our funding for things that were going to be more sustainable.
I mean, the years I've been here, I ain't going to tell you nothing wrong. Jacksonville has been about the same. And I know we switch, from this area down here to out towards the commons and stuff like that. But like industrial, do we really want industrial here? Or is it something that's a hindrance?
You want it here.
We want it here, but our limitations, unfortunately, is just driving down Marine Boulevard, and you are flanked on both sides by our electrical grid that's up in the air. A lot of industry doesn't want to take a chance that Hurricane so-and-so is coming through and knocking out the grid, because all our power lines are above ground. I mean, if you're running a call center, and I know this, what used to be Paladin and a few others, but Alcora, they have a sister site in Wilmington. And it's because, I mean, they didn't put it all here, because they know their power is going to be totally put out at some point in time, whether it's that snowstorm that comes through or that hurricane. And they have these signed contracts as a customer service agency to big clients, so they have to have a backup. Now, manufacturing plants, mine safety appliance, and Standardine aren't on that strict a scale. And mine safety appliance, is a subsidiary of the main company out of Pittsburgh, and it's got multiple sites around the country. And the last time that they were doing three shifts was during the first Gulf War, and they had to manufacture all of the chemical suits. So it has to be some type of manufacturing that's also being done somewhere else in the way these companies look at those things. Now, we're not in a position to take on a car manufacturing plant locally. We don't have the population base, not like in Indianapolis or Cincinnati or, you know, for that matter, Charlotte or Greensboro. You know, they have the major population centers. We have a good one, but it's going to be something that has to be targeted and something that's not totally unique because of that worry that our infrastructure isn't going to be able to support it in the long run.
With that being said, one of the things we can do, however, to create more economic growth is by having programs, mentorship programs, training programs, different things within our community that's offered to help train the youth, the young people who are coming out of college, who are struggling and frustrated at the fact that they can't find or become gainfully employed, to keep them active so that the spirit of depression and frustration does not set in. Those programs must be implemented to keep our youth focused on things that will keep them motivated to move forward. Speaking of our children, my daughter as an example, she's 28 and desired a career in law enforcement. She worked on base and utilized some of the local resource programs that helped her regain some of the momentum that she needed until one of those opportunities opened within the correction system for her. But those programs are few and far in between. And those are the things that we have to bring up and stabilize within our community to, one, keep our county populated and people trained and keep them motivated and influence them to keep pushing, keep moving on. And those, you know, we have those resources here. We talked about arts earlier. We have those programs here with the Arts Council and other community resource programs that are underutilized. We have to utilize those programs to keep our people, our kids, our youth, our community engaged in what's going on here in Onslow County. And that will encourage people to want to start, not necessarily big industry, which is needed, but the infrastructure might not support, but to bring other businesses here that can support that. My humble opinion.
A very good resource, not often used, except by, sometimes by the college students, is the Career Center on board Coastal. That Career Center can help anybody find many of those jobs that are on board Camp Lejeune through contractors. And it's not always something that you can just log on to the local Employment Security Commission and find, because most of those are advertised, although they're not civil service, they're advertised within much of that system. They're there. They many times are going to require technical types of knowledge. But having children and in-laws ranging from 30 to 42, and all eight of them are employed locally and in some pretty good areas, they're there. Sometimes they need that mentor to show them how to find it.
I think that's a good point. So with that being said, if you would take this with you, if you have any other thoughts, we'll compile these suggestions and then come up, be prepared to talk with you at the next meeting about specific action steps or plan for moving these ideas forward.
Corey.
Yes.
Special request?
I'm sorry. I had a question about opportunities for extended activities. What was meant by that? Does anyone remember?
For extended opportunities.
That's one that
opportunities for extended activities. It came after new job requirements. Yeah. Anybody remember what that was?
I don't even know who said it.
And I wonder if that really related back to the high school side.
I think you're right. I think that
back to the Arts Council.
They were talking about
not just arts,
beyond
but just
sports.
Any type. Mm-hmm. You know, the they chess were, club. The yeah. you know the
mm-hmm.
the different okay. types like that.
And one of the young ladies was talking about places like if you don't have internet service at
yes,
home.
Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm. And if you do have, and you know, school, of course, at school, you've got a library, which I think does, what, an hour? You've got to sign up for mm-hmm. it. It's 1 hour, you know. And it makes a huge difference for a child in so many ways if they have access at home. You can monitor as a parent, but you know, too many parents will have cable TV and have any number of things coming over the airwaves and have no problem with that, but won't set up internet service for the child to explore the internet because, oh, I don't want you finding the wrong thing. You have ways to monitor this. In the meantime, they're watching Cinemax after dark. And you're asleep because you don't even know it's on.
Right.
And you're scared. You're not scared of that, but you're scared of them doing internet when you can build protections into your internet system. But she was talking about ways where kids could go somewhere and it could be a safe environment after school closes, that you could be somewhere. And I got the impression she was concerned that you got kids who are in the street or somewhere they don't need or belong in. They're hanging out at the mall because they have no place safe to go. Mm-hmm. And she talked about drug abuse and so forth. You know, one thing I just thought in general about those young people who were there the other night, was they were just phenomenal. They really were. Mm-hmm. And it just shows you that we don't listen to them often enough. When we had to have a spokesperson for our group, we had one person initially, and then we sent our young lady up. I keep wanting to say little girl. Our young lady up, and she was excellent in her presentation, getting our ideas across. And I don't know if there is a way or a place to have a youth, especially for groups who meet in the evening, to have a seat for, even if it's a non-voting seat, on committees like this, to give some input. She had excellent ideas, and we just were writing them down, and she and another young lady were talking about extended, I think that's what she meant, that after school is over with, and you may still not have a safe place. Maybe your mom is a single parent and she works at BP station on the 4 to 12 shift. So you get home 2:30, and from 2:30 until midnight, you're there by yourself. And while DSS might not want to hear that, the bottom line is you're doing what you have to do. She's not creating any problems, he's not creating any problems, but they're not in what you would really consider the safest environment. And she talked about that. Another young person talked about the same thing. So I think that's what that was. Yeah.
Okay. She also mentioned that it would be a learning center or something like the Y. That it's a center that they could go to and computers are set up and you can go and kids can interact and use the center at certain periods of time.
So do they not do that right across the street as well? I mean, is that not...
It's not set up like computers and stuff.
One thing is, this is something we can research, is I know the computers are there.
Okay.
What we need to find out is how many youth in the community know is there, what type of resource or programs are on those computers that they could use. Mm-hmm. I know it's being used a lot for after school programs with the recreation department and the youth council meets over there pretty periodically and have some different events there, but I don't know that we would consider that the team hangout place. But that's exactly what it was intended to be. That's exactly what it was intended to be. So that's something we can...
On many of these, I would defer to the youth council to come up with the list of desires.
Right.
And then... We think about how we can help.
How we can help them.
Now,
good idea.
And I never want to beat dead horses, but our last council meeting, we all agreed that it was at the very pinnacle of our desires for a swimming pool in the area.
Well, let me give you an update on the swimming pool.
Yeah. And especially, and I bring this out, when we talk the public-private partnership, and in terms of the YMCA or the Boys Girls Club, that really creates a safe zone, and it can be outfitted with those computers and all those things.
That's what she was talking about.
I do have some information I can provide on a pool. First off, it would not be a CDBG eligible activity in any way, shape, or form. So we wouldn't be paying for it. So we want to say that. But there has been some research done on the pool, and as I understand it, there has been some reports given by city council as to why we don't have a pool. And I think there's probably been some, over time, people have forgotten.
And in addition to the pool, some of the other items that are on this list, the manager is going to propose that when the advisory committees come back together in April for the recognition dinner, that you get a report back on what's been going on with some of these requests, why they're moving, why they're not moving, what are the plans. And so you will hear more about the pool. I know he has asked Susan to do some research on this topic. It's from a recreation perspective, they've been assigned to provide that feedback to the city manager.
Oh, good.
And then he'll provide a response back to the committees on the status of the pool.
What would it...
Other counties have...
Oh, yeah, they do.
All around us.
What would it take?
How do they do that?
Well, we've got...
What would it take to convince the Y program at its highest pinnacle that it's worth their time and effort to put something here?
I would think at a minimum it would take inviting a representative from the National YMCA Board and having a community discussion about the interest and finding out what the Y requires and if we can accommodate that.
You know,
the question is being, how does a Y set up in a community?
Yeah.
That's the research that needs to be done.
Boys and Girls Club.
Yes, there's a reason. Well, we have the Boys and Girls Club.
No, I mean a real one.
Yeah. We're not talking a real room at Jackson.
The building.
Yeah.
What I can tell you, one is it takes money.
Yes.
And I can also tell you, just in talking with even the Boys and Girls Club out of Wilmington, the demographics and the market and the sponsorships and support, totally different. Wilmington, New Hampshire County is more economically wealthy, I should say, as far as their giving than this community. We do not have the corporations here. And when you look at the number of nonprofits we have, and they're all soliciting from the same group
of people,
you don't have a whole lot of money left to start a new business if you're going to rely on the same corporate sponsors to help get it off the ground.
It's the same people who support the Museum of the Marine, that support, you know, the Navy Corpsmen, that support this, that support, you know.
So the pie is only so big.
It's always the same people.
It's divided as it is divided. So should you desire to have a Y come in, and that Y needs corporate sponsors, who are they going to go to get the support? Then the pie gets divided thinner, which may then compromise some of the other programs that you also want. So there's the challenge.
But then I would throw on top of that challenge something I've been saying for years and years, to get the county and the city to put money to the co-op and putting money into a pot and hiring a professional grant writer. And I'm not talking about you two, because you have 25, 8, 369 on your plate already. But we continually, it seems to me from this point of view, ask when these issues come up, they ask existing staff to investigate, to write it, and to implement it, and that is not possible. You need to have in a community of this size someone who does nothing. That is their job. I see it in Raleigh. There are people employed by state government who don't do anything else. One of them was my namesake. That was her job, to go hunt down money to implement the ideas that came around. She didn't do anything else. She didn't get involved in how you did it. All her thing was find the money, work with the staff to write it, get it approved, and at any given time, I remember one year they were running 5 Kate B. Reynolds grants through just DHHS. And this will not happen and cannot happen with existing staff. Stop trying to do it that way. Hire someone and put some money in here so you get a top-flight person. I mean, someone who really knows what they're doing. Share the cost of the travel and the benefits, because you can't, these imaginary lines between the city and the county are just that. They are political and imaginary boundaries. Have nothing to do whatever with the fact that I happen to live on this street and across the street is where you live, and you don't live in the city, you live in the county now. Those are political boundaries. I'm talking about, you know, this is one county, and we need someone to, and to keep from having to spend a huge amount and to make this a county only or a city only. Combine this, and don't get that person in and hired, and then proceed to have every department throw on their desk what they can't or don't want to be bothered with, which is what had happened the last time we did this. Make sure you're doing this and doing it for the right reason. That's how you find money for Y's and swimming pools and things of this nature.
But I would ask this, and not count the swimming pool.
Okay.
Yeah. What is it that the Y would offer that our current recreation and parks programs doesn't offer? And I think that's another question that gets asked. We have, I don't know, how many parks facilities? Mm-hmm. We have after-school programs in all of the elementary mm-hmm. schools. There's a place.
If anything, it'd be extended hours.
Okay, see, that's something that's probably cheaper than investing in the building and construction of a new Y. Mm-hmm. See what I'm saying? So find out what it is that we don't feel we're getting with our current rec, and what's the unmet need versus bringing in another organization that's going to need capital and operating dollars, and is that more cost effective than figuring out how to keep our rec?
But what you already have in the recreation mm-hmm. is the middle schoolers and below. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, some of the middle schoolers are latchkey. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
All of the high schoolers are, and you're not getting any of the high schoolers into that rec facility.
Okay. Unless they play even, a particular
unless they play sports.
Unique sport.
Mm-hmm. Right, right. But I'm talking about, you know, the Northwoods rec facility.
Right.
You know, which has after school and all those things. You don't get high schoolers.
Well, let me do this then. Let me work with Carmela and have her pose that same question to her youth council group.
Mm-hmm.
Because I would want to hear, why don't you participate in the rec centers? And what are your expectations for why? And if the city did it, would you participate? You know, that because I hear a lot of stuff, too, about this. With so much social media, there's really not as much face-to-face interaction and outdoor play and mm-hmm. that we are used to doing and going to places that we can text and not really have to see you face-to-face. So I'd be interested to hear what their perspective is on what it is when they say they want a why. What are you really saying you want? Because for me right now, why is a building?
I think,
what do you want in the matter of programming, activities, other than sports specifically, that should the city of Jacksonville, even if we had to partner with somebody else and mm-hmm. work that out,
and maybe
what would
their
that
answer
like?
Is not why, but Wi-Fi.
Wi-Fi, that could be exactly it.
I think that it's a funding issue, it's a budget issue, it's a money issue. We don't have the resources, the manpower, the money to put people in place to protect the children. You know, when I first came here, we had more recreational facilities open long term. Mm-hmm. And then when things happened, they became overcrowded, overpopulated, and they didn't have the staff to watch and monitor, and we started to shut those things down. So mm-hmm. one of the things is budget, mm-hmm. is budget constraints, mm-hmm. and that's unfortunate. And as long as you don't have the staff to man these particular places, you can open up 50 facilities. If you don't have the staff to man them, the facilities are useless.
But see, just saying something to that, what you just said. Now, when I worked on base and I retired in 2012, I had a lot of the guys that come in because I worked in accounting and for the staff personnel. But anyway, they would come in, they would say, a lot of the retirees, they were looking for things to do because a friend of mine, most of them are in Rolling Thunder. I know y'all got to know Rolling Thunder. But most of them volunteer for everything. Mm-hmm. Like Jim, my friend, the one that he rides the bike, he volunteered to be a school crossing guard. He volunteered to go and watch the children. He said, I'll go anywhere. And when the door, I know you know where the door is. Mm-hmm. When they moved out of there and we was thinking about, I was asking, he said, well, why don't the city get that place so the kids will have a place to meet? He said, I got a bunch of retired first sergeant majors be glad to go out and watch the kids and teach them, you know, young men how to be men and, you know, do different things like this.
And that's
and the thing about, and they
connection.
Would be working for free.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And he would say that would give us something to do hands-on mm-hmm. instead of sitting in the house all day long, eating and getting fat, he said, and not being able to get on our motorcycle.
Well,
and he used to be he's a retired policeman. And that's what I'm saying. You've got the staff, but they don't utilize them.
Well, I will say this, too. I almost forgot. The youth council did have a leadership summit in December, and they have brainstormed a lot of this stuff. Mm-hmm. And so I will defer to that group to digest what they felt, and once they report back on what their priorities are, which is one of the reasons why they were invited to the summit, because they had their leadership summit, and they wanted to find out how do they communicate those things to city council. So it was a perfect time to bring them to the table, and it was a great idea. So let's work with Carmela and the youth council on framing a response to these
back to that. That's
questions.
A good idea. Mm-hmm. They know more about
and
what they,
take,
what they want.
Can,
and we
can you also add their, and maybe this is just me, Jacksonville is not huge, but it's large enough that wouldn't you need more than one place? You wouldn't just want everyone, say if we were using that building over there, to come to that building from all over Jacksonville, would they need more than one site?
They would, and that's what she said.
They would need several, depending on what you need it, as well.
Another place.
All over campus.
Thought about that, too.
They were doing a wish list, and I thought it was a good idea for them to.
Yeah.
And they were very clear about.
Yeah, they know what they want, so, yeah.
Okay.
We're sitting here trying to figure it out, they know. All righty, sorry.
Are those the items for the next agenda, or are we still on the consideration?
Well, that definitely would be on the next agenda.
All those will be on the next agenda?
Yes.
Take that. Okay, any questions or comments? I think anybody else has.
I just wanted to remind the members that I will be sending out a request for you to respond. Let me know whether or not you want to be attending the community input meeting. And also, we're going to be looking for volunteers to review our nonprofit applications for funding. So if you are available, please let me know so that we can add you to the list for that review process.
Do you know what time or dates you're going to take a look at the nonprofit list? Yeah, I mean, I assisted last year.
It'll probably be sometime in March. Mid-March, when we did a review.
Mid to late March,
yeah,
I can help.
We'll send you the dates.
We'll send you the dates.
Yeah.
Okay, I hope I have my computer back then.
And I would mention, just as an announcement, I guess we would say, is that several people have attended the nonprofit, I mean, the boardsmanship training that the city and does every year. Mm-hmm. And if you have an organization that wants to apply for city or county funding, my understanding of the rules, one of them is that at least half of your board needs to have had some type of professional training on what it means to be a board member over the course of a year. And this is offered free. You don't have to truck somebody up to Raleigh and put them in a hotel and pay for tuition. It's free here. And I think it's February 2nd and 3rd.
This year. Yes.
And the invite's already out because I registered this morning. And it is done through United Way. So I think I got mine from United Way.
You should have. Mm-hmm.
But in case anybody is interested in signing up for that, you know, and I would recommend that, again, very highly to any organization, fraternities, sororities, churches, any group, because it really does give you some nice training on what it means to actually serve
on a board.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Any more questions or comments? Hearing none. At the right time?
Next meeting, Thursday, April 6th.
That's right.
6 p.m.
Do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
It has been moved and properly second that this meeting is now adjourned.